There was a story about a righteous man that sat with his helper. They were learning, whatever. And while they were talking, that rabbi, that righteous man, took a small box of tobacco, smelling tobacco, and just moved it from one spot on the table to the other. And his helper looked at him and told him, "Please, Rabbi, tell me why you did that." And he told him, "Nothing, just like moved the box." And he told him, "No, Rabbi, you never do anything with no reason. For sure you had a hidden reason for that thing. Please tell me the truth." And he was pushing. And in the end, the rabbi told him, "You know what? There was an intention for that thing, and you will know soon." And after a couple of minutes, a woman came into town and ran into the synagogue and opened the Holy Ark and started crying and said, "Thank you, Hashem, for the miracle," whatever. She went to the river and she was making, like, washing the laundry. And her baby was in a basket, something like that. And a wave came and took her baby to the other bank, other side of the river. And she didn't know what to do, and there was wind and whatever, and she was screaming, and suddenly another wave brought the baby back to her arms, and it was a clear miracle. So the helper realized that the rabbi was that spiritual hand that was bringing back, delivering back the baby to that woman. So now once I gave a class and I explained, I said, look, if you would hear a story, let's say for an example, on the Baal Shem Tov HaKadosh, on one of the righteous people that are known to be those ones that made wonders, and there are many tales and stories, fantastic, real things like Moses. We believe in that man, that he was able to open the sea. If we wouldn't believe that there are people that are able to, that we saw miracles through them, we wouldn't follow Hashem. We wouldn't believe. In our hearts, there are people that we can say, that person is different. That is a man of God. That is a woman of God. They made wonders. We believe in those. So if you would hear a story on the Baal Shem Tov, for an example, that he went in the forest and one time he decided to do something that every person does. He picked an apple from the tree. I don't know, I'm making up a fantasy now, just nothing, yeah? And then he would come and tell a story. On that apple, there was a life, that reincarnation that came in and dressed itself into that apple. And when I bite that apple, so I set free that soul. You would buy that story, right? Why? Because it's a Baal Shem Tov. There's a story on Dari HaKadosh that was walking with his student Rabbi Chaim Vital, and suddenly he kicked a stone, a round stone, and Dari HaKadosh is walking and re-kicking that stone, and Rabbi Chaim Vital looked at him for that, like, reason why you kicked that stone. So Dari HaKadosh is answering to him, "You're asking yourself, why did I kick that stone? There was a soul that was stuck in that stone for 500 years waiting for me to set it free." So great. So why are we believing? Why we buy that story? Because it's Dari HaKadosh. And on Dari HaKadosh we can believe. But I'm asking you, why can't you believe in yourself? Because when you're walking in the street, you're also kicking a stone. And when you see an apple on the tree, you also pick it and you make a bite. You bite it, you eat. The fact that you don't have the eyes of the Baal Shem Tov to see the soul that is trapped in the apple or in that stone like the Dari HaKadosh doesn't mean that there is no soul in that object, in that stone, in that fruit. So when you move a box of tobacco, or your box of cigarette, or your matches box, or your whatever, you move your pen, and you are not aware to what you do, it doesn't mean that the Creator is not attaching spiritual threads and strings to that physical part, to that object, without you being aware.